I love the British people, but let's be honest about it. You can't get excited about their humor, about the way they talk. I could get excited.
The English sense of humor, you've got to have a critical mind.
I'm not a jingoist, sir. Never have been, never will be.
I think we're more dry than the Americans.
I don't know. That English dry wit just doesn't do it for me.
Englishmen are not funny. It's not a question of funnier. As about no!
I did not doubt the truth of Mr. Welb's observation for a moment that he has never personally seen a gorilla laugh. The reason is, sir, that you are English, and gorillas too prefer American humor.
You decide who's funnier when comedy breaks loose as Steve Allen and Alan King defend America's sense of humor. Watch Great Confrontations at the Oxford Union.
TV funny. Dallas is incredibly hysterical. You can't deny that. I mean, the reason that Bobby Ewing had to leave was that they found him rehearsing.
Says no one who has ever seen an Englishman dressed to go abroad can doubt the wisdom of the notion that Englishmen are very, 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 very funny.
I did not doubt the truth of Mr. Welb's observation for a moment that he has never personally seen a gorilla laugh. The reason is, sir, that you are English, and gorillas too prefer American humor.
From England, Great Confrontations at the Oxford Union. Another installment in the PBS series. Tonight's debate is on the motion that Englishmen are funnier than Americans. On the road and battling for their country, the USA, Steve Allen and Alan King against the home side for England, Jasper Carrot and John Wells. May the better wits win.
Good evening. I'm Bud Collins of the Boston Globe, and this is the arena, the Oxford Union. Since 1820, great debates have been held here. It isn't Wimbledon. It isn't a golf course. It isn't a cricket pitch. But there have been wonderful battles here between debaters. Blood has been drawn. Barb-to-barb combat, word wars. And we have another one tonight, and it's part of the old, old rivalry that goes back to the 1770s, the United States against Great Britain, two countries that have been divided by senses of humor. So for the American team, we have two men who can hold their own, Alan King, Las Vegas, television, movie, humor. You know Alan King, he's a battler. And Steve Allen, once of the Tonight Show, a genius, author, musician, songwriter, everything, Allen and King. For Great Britain, John Wells, an eminent writer of comedy in England, a TV and movie star. He has starred with Dudley Moore and Peter Sellers, and his partner, well known to the British television viewers, Jasper Carrot. Carrot and Wells.
On the road to Oxford, he asked a few people, who is funnier?
I love the British people, but let's be honest about it. You can't get excited about their humor, about the way they talk. I could get excited.
You have to understand the English sense of humor. The American sense of humor, you don't have to think about it. You just either have to laugh at it or not. The English sense of humor, you've got to have a quick mind.
I'm not a jingoist, sir. Never have been, never will be.
I think we're more dry than the Americans.
I don't know. That English dry wit just doesn't do it for me.
I think Englishmen and Americans are very funny. I would want to see them work in Soviet Union, but you can't talk about politics, government, sex, and religion. You can talk about fish. Buttons are very funny. Zippers are hilarious.
The American humor is low. Is low. He has no deeper ideas as we like to have.
I think English people are delightful, charming, warm, lovely people. They're not as funny as Americans, but then I'm prejudiced.
I can understand Jackie Mason, Yakov Smirnoff, but English comedians? Every time I watch them, I've got to read the English titles.
I have seen Mr. Wells in films. His face is familiar. I've seen an 8x10, and I remember seeing that face before. I'm not familiar with Mr. Carrot, except in his capacity as a vegetable.
I mean, if you've seen the poster, it's like Jasper Cat plus John Wells, and like Alan King and Steve Allen. Like in, now, to an American, that is a major insult.
We really do approach comedy from two different... Yeah.
Nice guy, tough guy, as we say in the police business.
He's, I think that Steve is known for his wit, you know, and I go for the throat, you know.
Yes. Who's Steve Allen and Alan King? We don't know them. I mean, they're major stars in America. Very, very accomplished comedians. I mean, Steve Allen is just... have you read his biography? It takes an hour. I mean, he's written 4,000 songs. He's either a genius or he's mental. I mean, he must write songs with 8 notes. And I mean, God, how do you write 4,000 songs? How do you think up 4,000 titles, let alone write damn songs? I mean, he's there.
That's what we need. Notre Dame spirit in Oxford. We need all you Americans to continue in the American tradition. Vote twice, vote three times. Stuff the ballots. Go on to victory.
Peter Jay, the former British ambassador to the United States, has been here before for this kind of bloodshed. Former president of the Union. Can you give us the ground rules, Peter?
Well, the ground rules are the same, Bud, as they've been for over 100 years in this famous hall. It's very simple, basically. One speaker gets up and proposes the motion for one side. Another speaker on the other side opposes, and then it goes back and forth between the two sides until the conclusion of the debate. Any member can at any time vote by walking out through one of two doorways, one marked aye, which means yes, you're supporting the motion, the other marked no, you are opposing the motion, and you can notify the tellers, as they're called, counting the votes, that you wish to abstain.
Who wishes to abstain from voting should notify
these
the tellers.
These are time-honored words that everybody has read out every week for over 100 years.
I call upon Robert Mackay, Christchurch ex-librarian, to propose the motion standing in his merit.
Now, Peter, first up, we have four of Oxford's funniest students.
Well, what is American humor? I mean, to many, it's typified by the unbelievable attire of the average tourist from the US of A. Or maybe it's because that Americans are, in fact, amusing. Because the average Milwaukee cab driver is so culturally unaware and stupid that he thinks Botticelli is a great new pizza topping. Proust is one of those new sauces that you dip your chicken McNuggets in. And so politically naive that he thinks manual labor is the Spanish prime minister.
He's got off some very good lines there.
Not bad.
Milwaukee taxi driver.
Yes, Mr. President, Americans are funny. But they're not half as funny as the sort of Englishman who will follow me now. Nick, look at me, I'm a lamppost, Thomas. He's going to stand up and thereby conclusively prove to the House that he's so thin that he has to supplement his diet by photosynthesizing.
This is very much a part of the Union tradition, which is gently abusing your opponent.
Well, the old bag of lard was going good, wasn't he? It's the first time I've been in danger of being figuratively overshadowed by Rob Mackay. Rob Mackay, the only man I know who can run into a brick wall with an erection and bruise his navel. I actually believe that American comedy is superior to English comedy. I ought to offer a word of apology to our American audience, because I feel they might be a little disappointed by the informality in which these proceedings are being conducted tonight. You see, there is a reason for this. We have television here this evening, and unfortunately, the heat generated by the lights makes it impossible for us to wear the suits of armor and... I and of course the ermine robes, which we normally wear when debating in this chamber. The presence of television also means that the proceedings will be a little shorter than usual. You see, ordinarily, in the middle of the debate, we have a break for roast beef and Yorkshire pudding. Then, of course, after the debate is over, the president normally beheads the secretary with his ancestral broadsword, and then we all go back to our thatched cottages and drink tea from our Andy and Fergie commemorative mugs.
Nevertheless, the Americans are fundamentally serious people. We British colonized people. We went to their countries, we killed them, we took them over, and this is an intrinsically hilarious activity. We gave the world, we British, an inferiority complex, which is an extremely amusing thing to give the world. And yet the Americans announce in their constitution that they pursue happiness. We British don't have to pursue happiness. We are happy. I am happy, and I shall die roaring with laughter. Our great national institutions, Mr. Chairman, such as the Archbishop of Canterbury, exist purely for their entertainment value. The Labour Party exists exclusively to provide mild comic relief for stockbrokers. America, Mr. Chairman, is the only civilization in history which was founded on common dreams and which idealizes ordinary men and women. I hope it never leaves that particular vision, but I say that it is an uncanny vision. Indeed, when I was in California, I wanted to do some surf riding, but the surfs in California did not particularly like it.
Steve, Alan King, as we lovingly refer to them, have come thousands of miles here. They're not here because Mrs. Thatcher says that she misses a good yank now and then. They're here to defend America's greatest natural resource, her comedy. For you, English have had the audacity to proclaim British humor king. Well, it just won't wash. Frankly, we didn't win the Second World War for you people to be treated this way. Now, of course, perhaps it would not go astray to discuss the many different levels of humor. The great chain of comic being is, in fact, filled with many different levels. There is, of course, on the lowest level and on the lowest denomination, visual humor. This is, of course, a cheap laugh, 35 pence at the covered market, and frankly, it didn't work that well. But but it serves to prove a point, which is that visual humor is, of course, associated with its close cousin, slapstick humor.
And with very great pleasure, I call upon John Wells to speak in favor of the motion.
John Wells, a very well-known British comic. He's invented this Dear Bill column in our Private Eye magazine.
The motion before this House is one that touches chords deep in the human spirit. It sounds a challenge deep down in the labyrinths of the subconscious memory, awakening centuries-old fears, dark terrors that have slumbered undisturbed, monsters and hobgoblins long banished from the irrational mind. Many of them, clothed in form, have spoken here this evening already. And I appeal first to the evidence of the senses. No one who has ever seen an Englishman dressed to go abroad can doubt the wisdom of the motion that Englishmen are very, 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 very funny. No one who's seen an Englishman undressed in his own home can doubt the wisdom of the notion that Englishmen are very, 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 very funny indeed, let alone undressed in someone else's home. It is this antechamber of sartorial conflict, the shocking juxtaposition between the Englishman clothed and the Englishman unclothed, that I wish to take you first of all this evening. I would like you, if you will, to twitch off in your mind's eye the clothes from any Englishman, let us say the Archbishop of Canterbury, picturing, if you will, the conflict between the elegance of his ecclesiastical garb and the surprising pouches of flesh, charming little dimples, unexpected hirsute appendages that constitute the unidealized male nude. Now, it might be argued by our guest tonight that other foreigners, for example, like Colonel Gaddafi or President Reagan, might look equally amusing standing about with very few clothes on. I would like, by the way, en passant, to thank the organizers for building this uniquely accurate fiberglass reproduction of a 19th century union building in order to make our American visitors, and welcome to all out there, feel more at home. I spoke in my opening observations of dark terrors, monsters, and hobgoblins that are going to be aroused by this debate, and I'm now going to touch upon them very delicately and without causing any alarm, I assure, or embarrassment. I refer, of course, to the psychological origins of our mirth. In chimpanzees, for example, it is terror. Gorillas, on the other hand, never laugh. Well, I've never seen a gorilla laughing. Have we, on American television, been hysterically signaling
of this society seeking to intervene, who is a very regular intervener over several years in this society?
John, darling, ducky. I've actually longed to have a little chat with you in private.
Oh, well, why don't we have it here?
Yes, here's my chance.
Good.
Why? Could you just answer me a few questions?
Are you by any chance American?
Sir, I come from Mars. They've spared no expense in this show.
I think you should go back to Mars and tell her you're out rather late.
John, darling, you just piped out. Why is it that listening to you with that voice like a young corncrake being interfered with makes one think of oral sex with a shark? John, would you tell me if you're suffering from halitosis of the intellect? Did you once have electric shock treatment during a power cut? And most of all, darling, do you smoke after intercourse? I suppose you never look.
All together. Finally, if anything there is, we have any gift in the way of voluntary humor, I would only point you to our inspiration, which is this. Think to yourself over the whole realm of humor, what is analysis can one come to? Jokes about our betters when their trousers are down, jokes about man, woman, beast, jokes always about foreigners are very, very funny when there are more of you than there are of them. Jokes about people who can't pronounce their words. Jokes about people a different color from you. Jokes about people with easy catchphrase names like Wogs or Yanks. All bear one thing in common. It is the herd comfortably laughing at the outsider. Now, if it's the overdog laughing at the underdog, what race on earth, having surrendered our great empire to our conquerors on thy left, could more suitably be described in the civilized world as the underdog than England? In other words, we are not only intrinsically the most ridiculous, but also we are an ideal subject for humour. And we are inspired, I think, in this by the early Israelis, who, as you know, are God's chosen race for making jokes. He chose them to make jokes because they make jokes very like his own. These jokes are all rather not only attacking the underdog, they attack the underdog when one is the underdog oneself. These are what called implosive jokes, really. I put it to you, gentlemen, that Englishmen are infinitely more ridiculous than Americans, and even occasionally funnier. I move you to go through that little door and have a word with Mr. Pratt. What a lovely name for a person took me out.
I call upon Steve Allen to speak against the motion.
Steve Allen, well received.
Warm reception from the British students for Steve Allen.
Thank you very much, Your Eminence. I submit that there are respects in which Americans are funnier, and quite seriously, respects in which the English are funnier. One of you did indeed refer to the fact that in more formal circumstances you might be wearing armor here this evening. And given the heat in this chamber, I think that had you done so, you would have invented the microwave much sooner, if I may. I did not doubt the truth of Mr. Welb's observation for a moment that he has never personally seen a gorilla laugh. The reason is, sir, that you are English, and gorillas too prefer American humor.
A very excellent piece of repartee, very successful.
Scoring well, Steve Allen.
But the one thing I would like to drive home this evening, outside of a used Daimler, is this realization, which is, and in all honesty, this is not a joke, comes as a great shock to me, because Americans, especially those of us who are middle class or worse, I think if you took a word association test as an American and somebody said English, you'd say dignity. Wouldn't you say that, Jane?
Oh, yes.
Well, what do you know? But no, American comedians are in public very rude to their wives, but never in private, may I say. No, there is, at least there was in my mind until about an hour ago, this tremendous sense, innate sense, inherent sense of English dignity, a reputation unlikely to last past this particular proceeding, I must say. I've also never heretofore encountered a voting procedure which involves your walking through various doors of this eyes, nose, ear, and throat office, or whatever it is. We've seen this evening, and we have much other evidence, that there are many funny Englishmen. That's beyond question. But at one time you used to run what is now considered the area of Palestine. I do not know of any Palestinian comedians that you you left behind. To make it more immediate, I submit that Arafat is not funny. Chicken fat is funny. But on the other hand, I perhaps am doing Mr. Arafat an injustice, because anyone who would wear an Italian tablecloth for a hat, I can see something funny about that. When I think of the history, the cultural, the political history, which has taken place literally in this space that we occupy tonight, as the old saying goes, if these old walls could only talk, they would probably say, paint me. I'm particularly pleased to be here because I am something of a world traveler, and I love to learn. When you travel, you're automatically a student, you're an ignorant foreigner, so to speak. Gesundheit. And that's what I often do. I travel about the world listening to people sneeze and then responding very quickly. And the English do sneeze funnier, that I concede. Much, much funnier than the Americans. I would have ignored an American sneeze at a moment like that. But the last trip in which Jane and I made together was to China. One of my books, in fact, is titled Explaining China. And the thing that struck me of so much that was impressive about that country was that just after the dreadful period of what's called the Cultural Revolution, as many of you would be well aware, a time when the intellectuals and artists suffered severely, the country was actually being run by Mao Zedong's widow, Chang Qing, which was remarkable if you think of it because of her own personal and professional background. She was actually, as a young woman, a B-movie actress, literally, in the film studios of Shanghai. So it was quite remarkable, I thought, that here was an instance of someone who used to work in B-movies running one of the world's great countries. Already been mentioned by one of the earlier speakers that the United States, people of the United States, seem to have largely abandoned the work ethic, which is deplorable because that is not so much nearly the case in Great Britain and other parts of Europe. Even Europe's greatest artists have always been distinguished not only by their genius, which is obvious, but by their dedication to hard work and struggle. The great Tchaikovsky, when asked if it had not been extremely difficult to write the suite for which he is best noted, said, "Oh, yes, it was a real nutcracker." So, yes, Alan, yes. Basic proposition could be argued endlessly in the abstract, and has already, as a matter of fact. I think if we deal with specifics, therefore, it might bring the whole issue into somewhat clearer focus for us. I'm just going, if I may, to recite quickly the names of a few of the greatest comedians in the American comic tradition, stars of vaudeville, stars of motion pictures, stars of comedy records, television, the whole spectrum of funniness in America. Just the recitation of the names, I think, will bowl you over. Charlie Chaplin, for example. Oh, I'm sorry, he was English. Yes, that's right. Well, another name, the great Stan Laurel, undoubtedly one of the funny... Oh, I'm sorry, he was English, too. Yeah. Well, Bob Hope is certainly... Oh, I did it again. Yeah, Bob Hope is also English in origin. Well, think of more recent films. All the great American comedies of the last 10 years or so have starred either Peter Sellers or Dudley Moore. Seem to it. And when we think of the great American master of drawing room comedy, Cary Grant. Oh, shoot. Now, there is certainly no issue in modern times concerning which the Americans and the English could be literally enemies. We may oppose each other, but we could never be enemies because almost all Americans are spiritual, cultural, and physical descendants of Europeans, and many of us of you. It has been said that England is our mother, France our mistress, and Germany our teacher. Unfortunately, whoever said that did not identify our father. Now, I was so glad that when Mr. King did that amusing bit of business a moment ago, that you did nothing more than laugh heartily. I warn you not to unduly antagonize Mr. King by ad hominem attacks or anything of the sort. Make your points as vigorously as you wish, but don't waken this sleeping tiger. Mr. King is, he concedes this himself, he is an angry man. His wife is an angry woman. He has several furious children, as a matter of fact. No, I go for the jocular and he goes for the jugular. There was reference to the issue of sex on television. And that is still a matter of great controversy and significance in the United States. I personally don't object to it. I just would argue that you'd have to be awfully careful of the antenna. But again, what English and American humor share is a sense of the ridiculous. And we earlier referred to the physical impairment of dyslexia. I don't know how many of you are familiar with the other physical impairment called acromegaly, in which the extremities, the feet and the hands and the jawbone are terribly misformed. But as I once said, even to a man with acromegaly, why the long face? So we do. Now that is what we call in America a shock laugh. And I'm shocked that you laughed at it, if I may say so. In any event, I'm going to turn over the floor to my associate in a moment after, of course, Mr. Carrot, who I'm sad to report is a vegetable. He will have at you. But I thank you for your kind attention, and I oppose the motion.
That's right.
On Jasper Carrot to speak in favor of the motion.
Very, very enthusiastic reception for Jasper Carrot. I guess most of the students when they were kids saw his programs on British television.
For the benefit of our American viewers, I come from a place called Birmingham. It's Britain's second largest city, comprising mainly of 1.5 million people with a speech defect. In fact, if I was to talk proper Brummage, you wouldn't have a bleeding clue what I'm on about. As to the motion, well, comedy is above all subjective. So I'm going to base my support for the motion on personal observations made here and in America, backed up by extensive empirical research rather than epistemological assumption. Are Americans funny? Well, Bob Hope, sure, he's English. Stan Laurel, you left someone out, Steve. Woody Allen. He is English. He has to be. You can only get spectacles like that from the National Health Service. Do you want to move across again? I'm sorry, there's no ice in here. You're used to ice in America. In fact, that's all you bloody well sell when you buy a drink in America. You get a great big bucket and they fill it full of bloody ice and they go, $5. To find out how funny Americans were, I went myself. Oh. I went to San Francisco, the comedy capital of America. San Francisco, a lonely town if you're a woman. In fact, they go on so much about San Francisco and homosexuality when you tell people you're going there. When I got there, I was quite relieved to find it wasn't compulsory. I met my wife in San Francisco. I said, what the bloody hell are you doing? I had the great pleasure of flying there on People's Express. I thought Virgin were cheap. We flew off from Gatwick and spent the first 2 hours crop spraying. I went first class. The stewardess told me off for not eating all my food. As she said, there were people in economy starving to death. Americans have a warped sense of humor at times. When you get to America, the first thing you have to do is to hire a car. I went to a company called Rent-A-Wreck. This is for real. What the Americans don't tell you is that that's what they rent. I hired a Corvette Stingray. Three-wheeler. Cellophane in the windows. I couldn't believe it. And I thought, well, I fancy a Corvette Stingray. I don't know whether you know this. I took it out on the road. There's a blanket 55 mile an hour speed limit in America. And I took it out into the highways. And I thought, what the hell? I'm only there for a couple of weeks. If they stop me, I don't have to pay the fine. 55 mile, you can't get out of first gear in a Corvette Stingray. And I'm driving. 15 G-force on me face. The cellophane's flapping in the window. I'm driving on the left-hand side of the road. We invented the steam engine, we'll tell you what side to drive. Now, obviously, driving like that, I eventually got stopped by the San Francisco Police Department. Now, I think there's an analogy here between, like, the English police and the American police and our humour and their humour. As you know, when the police stop you here, it's a bit more like Oscar Wilde, I suppose, you know. They pull up in front of you, they get out, walk up to the car. Do that ritual of putting their hat on, you know. Good evening, sir. And who's been a naughty boy? You've got to go with it, haven't you? Me, officer? How naughty have you been? Ever so naughty? Bastards. But not in America, it's more like Mel Brooks. Yeah. I mean, I was driving along and I saw this thing in the room. They drove by the side of me for about 2 minutes, two of them.
Hey! Mario Andretti! Pull over!
And he said, keep your hands on the steering wheel! Where the bleeding hell am I gonna pull out? So I pulled over to the side. And onto that little hard shoulder they have in America. It's not as big as ours. And it's full of potholes and dead cats. Now the thing is, in America, what I didn't know, and this is useful if you go there, the police in America always pull up behind you. In this country, they always pull up in front of you. I didn't know this. I am waiting for them to overtake me. They are waiting for me to stop. For 10 miles, we are bumping up and down their highway. I pulled over. He walked up, I wound the cellophane down. He sticks a six gun in the air. Woo! Now, I've had a few things in the air, but I've never had a six gun. I do find US TV funny. Dallas is incredibly hysterical. You can't deny that. I mean, the reason that Bobby Ewing had to leave was that they found him rehearsing. And every other program on American television is a quiz show. That's why there's so many cars in America. They win them all on these bloody quiz shows. Americans have some anal fixation. Every other advert is for bloody lavatory brushes or hemorrhoid creams, pessaries. I saw one, I couldn't believe one advert. It was Leonard Nimoy advertising laxative pills. A constipated Vulcan. You can't get it. Beware what happens there, because eventually we get it here. Now, McDonald's has taken some stick to them. Quite right, quite right. It's like a creeping dearth over our country. The first time I bought a Big Mac, I opened the box and I thought, it's been eaten already. We've got McDonald's everywhere in Birmingham. There's not a fish and chip shop left in Birmingham now. We've got no bloody time for fish and chips. You walk into a fish and chip shop and you hang about for about 10 seconds. You're like, come on, come on. What are you doing? Cooking the food. It's not just fast food, it's fast everything. It's the American way. You've got to have everything now. Give me now, I've got to have it now. You can't wait for anything, can you? I mean, like, who buys a car these days that does 0 to 60 in less than 8 seconds?
Nobody, because 8 seconds is a long time these days, isn't it? Well, it is, isn't it? Well, look, look. You see, you see? You're all sitting there going, bloody hell, this is a long time, isn't it? We could be doing 60 mile an hour by now.
What do you like? Big Macs?
Or cod chips and mushy peas? The first is fast, commercial, and successful. The second is traditional, honest, and satisfying.
Walk through the eyes.
And now, with very great pleasure, I call upon Alan King to speak last and against the motion.
Very warm reception for the big visitor.
I think he'll hammer away in the manner of Jasper Carrick.
I didn't realize that I'd come 4,000 miles to see a Carrick concert. I thought there was an issue to debate tonight. But I think that you have loaded the cards, have been totally unfair in the presentation. And by that I mean, up your ass, Charlie.
Well, he's pretty basic. Yep, I think he's got the mood. Deserting King as
I
King deserted
like
him.
To present as evidence A for the defense the method in which this evening was advertised. Casper Jarrett, John Wells, Oxford Union, live TV. The year's climax. Thursday, the 12th of June, 2015. The comedy debate on the 17th featuring Jasper Carrick, John Wells. Not even and others. PBS in New York. This is bloody war!
And Carrot has crossed the aisle.
This is war! For 4 hours, I couldn't light this bloody thing in this hallowed fire trap. A Sephardic bordello in Istanbul. But if I may regain my composure, I should like to present my credentials. For 45 years, I've been one of America's most successful and most sought-after comedians. So successful and so sought after that at the height of our season, June, I could come to this goddamn place. For free. I took this debate seriously. I did some research. I thought about it. I started in the Catskill Mountains, probably unknown to many of you, but it was the breeding ground and the incubator for some of America's greatest comedians in the mountains of upstate New York. That's one of the problems the English comedians don't have. There's no mountains in England. I came to the island of England in World War II And then in 1955, the late, great Judy Garland asked me if I'd appear with her at the Dominion Theatre in Tottenham Court Road in 55. And then I came in contact with my second type of British humor when Ken Tynan, who reviewed my act and said it wasn't Alan King that was bad, it was the way the theater was built. He said the seats faced the stage. So, Mr. President, distinguished members of the Oxford Union Hall, and ladies and gentlemen, Englishmen are not funny. It's not a question of funnier as the vote. No! Not funny! I don't know why this debate started. I mean, there are other nations that are not funny. You don't see them sitting around in a goddamn hot room till 3 o'clock in the morning debating the issue. Right now, there are no great books on humor coming out of Germany. The French are not funny. They're silly, but they're not funny. Russians, obviously, are not funny. The Dutch are not funny. I mean, America wasn't funny for 100 years because we were still under your influence. And then a little old Jew came. Steerage in the bottom of a boat, like cattle, that's why it was called steerage. And American humor began. Because you see, American humor began when we opened our arms to the immigrants, when the Italians and the Polish and the Jews and the Russians and everyone started to come to America. When we talk about humor, American humor is not elitist. American humor is the humor of the masses. I grew up in a funny home. My father, a little old Jewish gentleman, was funny. Jews in England are not funny. They speak English. I mean, a cup of tea is not funny. A glass of tea is funny. I grew up with Jewish jokes. By the way, if I may just digress for a moment, or take some time out. I would just like my worthy opponents to know, John Jasper, that I come with the permission of my father, who's 95 and a rabbi, in the New York section, the Brooklyn section, and I would like to make you both honorary Jews, which entitles you to 2,000 years of retroactive persecution.
We have to go through the cutting ceremony.
We have made a major breakthrough in the United States of America. And I say this with great sincerity, sociologically, that the three greatest stars in the United States of America at this moment are, in films, Eddie Murphy, a black. In concerts and recordings, Richard Pryor, a black. And third, the greatest success in the history of American television, Bill Cosby. Three blacks. Where are your Pakistani humorists? Show me. Show me where this humor, show me where this humor grows. Show me where this humor. Of course, blacks originally in America were not too funny. It was tough getting laughs when you're in chains, you know. But.
Standing on his seat. He's outmarching him.
Not funny.
My God! My God! I thought I was mad! I thought I was mad, but you're terrific!
Bloody hell! Sir, it is becoming distressingly clear to me that you were not at an English public school.
The public school in England, of course, being a private school.
I think the interrupter might be on the mark on that one.
You may look like Richard Gere with a fault on the horizontal hold. You have never played leapfrog in an English public school. How's that? How's that?
How's that? How's that? How's that? How's that? Now, wait a minute. Wait a minute. No, no, don't take him away. Let him spend the rest of the evening. I have made fun of 7 presidents in my country. I'm not about to stop now, especially now when it's easy. I was invited to the White House about 3 weeks ago, and there was a press conference on the lawn, the Rose Garden. The wind was blowing 50 miles an hour. Not one hair on Ronald Reagan's head moved. Now, I couldn't pay attention to what he was saying. I was fascinated by his hair. Palm trees were bending in the wind, trees. I mean, his hair didn't move, but his neck kept swaying up and back. Now, wait a minute. And here I'd come prepared to speak at the dinner that night. So I get there at the dinner, and I tell the story about the President of the United States who's sitting at my right, about his hair not, you know, moving. And I said, Mr. President, whatever you put on your hair, you ought to give your neck a couple of spritzes, you know? Now, he laughed. Thank God he laughed. But no, when my wife knew that I was going to tell that story, she said to me, you can't do it. And I said, why not? Well, what are they going to do to me? Take away my citizenship? You see, we elect these people. They're not ordained. We don't wait for puffs of smoke to come out of a chimney. There's always 5 guys waiting in the wings, as funny as the guy that was in. Ladies and gentlemen, how could you begin to compare English humor with American humor? You cannot compare the likes of Samuel Johnson and Disraeli and Oscar Wilde, and I've got them listed here somewhere. George Bernard Shaw, Winston Churchill, and Noel Coward, who said on the inauguration, on the coronation, forgive me, of your queen, he had escorted the Queen Mother and the Queen of Tonga, who was 6'9", 380 foot wide. Walked in with a little gentleman at her side, and the Queen Mother said to Noel Coward, who can that be? And Noel Coward said, probably her lunch. Now, that was not funny. You're not going to compare these gentlemen with the likes of the Three Stooges, Abbott and Costello, Jerry Lewis, Pee Wee Herman, giants, men that will continue through history. Volumes will be written about their humor. I beg you to realize the difference between English humor or wit or sarcasm or taking the mickey out of something or turning a phrase, which you are noted for, and I'm not making light of that contribution, to what the motion is about. Funny. Funny. I don't give a damn which way you vote. How do you like that?
great performance. A brilliant performance. And they love him for it.
Yeah, I think.
He really sucked it to them, and that's what they like, and that's what they respect, and that's what they enjoyed.
He was in a dead heat with Jasper Carrot, I'd say.
Yes, I think you're right. And the great thing normally in the funny debates is it doesn't matter the way anybody votes, but in this particular funny debate, well, that's part of the joke too. The president's now leaving the hall with his main guests, leaving his deputy, the librarian, to preside over any continuing debate amongst the ordinary members of the society.
There you see the doors, you see, with the eyes to the right, nose to the left, and the brass pole down the middle. So if you want to vote for the motion, that's the Englishmen are funnier than Americans, you can walk to the right, and vice versa if you take the opposite opinion.
And who's keeping score?
There are two people standing, one on each side, called the tellers. Tellers for the eyes, tellers for the nose. They have a scorecard, and they tick off with a pencil the numbers as they go through.
Well, Peter J., how do you vote?
Well, I think, as a former ambassador from one country to the other, I have to be neutral and impartial.
Oh, come on now. Come on.
I think that New Yorkers are funnier than anybody else.
The motion that Englishmen are funnier than Americans has been carried by 338 votes to 154 votes.
Well, that tells the story. The English are funnier, at least here at Oxford. 338 to 154 is the vote. So for Peter J., I'm Bud Collins, saying good night.
This program was produced and presented by Video Events International, which is solely responsible for its content. Funding.